There is no other Savior but Jesus. He's the only one that has come, the only one that has died, the only one that has risen from the dead, and the only one that's coming back again to the same place, what we call the second coming of Jesus Christ. So we need to understand that God does whatever He pleases because He's in control of this world.
Welcome to Somebody Loves You Radio, the Bible teaching ministry of Raul Reese in Diamond Bar, California. As a young man, Raul rejected Christ's gift of salvation, and it almost cost him his life. But by God's mercy, he finally learned that the only way to truly live was to give his all to Jesus fully and completely. For a free DVD of Raul's testimony, visit SomebodyLovesYou.com or call 800-634-9165. Today, Raul continues our series exploring God's desire for all people to walk in relationship with Him. Meditating on Christ's ultimate example of surrender and obedience, you'll be directed to think about your own personal level of commitment to the Lord. You'll see that when you lay aside your own agenda to seek God's will, He can work through you in ways you would have never expected. Here's Raul Reese now with the lesson, Doing God's Will, God's Way. If you have your Bibles, join us in Mark chapter 3, verse 31.
Jesus, in looking at his life, he's been a pretty busy person. When you read the Gospels all the way through Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, that he has a message, and that message is of salvation. There's no possible way that anybody can come into the kingdom of God unless they repent, unless they accept Christ by faith. And then God can begin to use your life as he baptizes you with the Holy Spirit. We dealt with Jesus sharing about the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit. This is a sin that you really have to be careful with. But let me read the text and we'll come back to it in a second. Chapter 3, verse 31 to the end. He says, then his brothers and his mother came and standing outside, they sent him and called him. And a multitude was sitting around him and they said to Jesus, look, your mother and your brothers are outside seeking you. But he answered and said to them, who's my mother? Who's my brothers? And then he looked around in a circle at those who sat about him and said, here are my mother, here are my brothers. For whoever does the will of God is my brother, my sister, and my mother. So he's dealing with a very important text here. But let me kind of go back just a little bit to the previous verses because I think that we need to understand that what Jesus last week was talking about, he was talking about people that hear the message like the scribes. You know, the scribes were following everywhere he went. People flocked to him because he was speaking truth. The scribes could have spoken truth, but they decided willfully not to speak to the people the message of truth. They were concerned with one thing. They were jealous of Jesus. They were jealous because of the message that he had for the people, the miracles, the wonders that he was doing. And yet they wanted him to be limited to the things that he was doing, as not only they wanted to lead and they wanted to be in charge, but they wanted to bring people into bondage. In Mark chapter 3, verse 28, he says, assuredly I say to you, says, all sins will be forgiven to the Son of Man, and whatever blasphemies they may utter, but he who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit never has forgiveness, but is subject to eternal damnation, because they said he had an unclean spirit. I think that we have to really be careful when we speak about people. Especially as believers, we judge other believers. But I think that here, you know, the Pharisees, as Christ, especially the scribes here, were misjudging Jesus, that he was literally Satan or one that was like Satan. Sometimes your family becomes your enemy, believe it or not. When you get saved, they begin to see the transformation. They begin to see the change in your life. that you're no longer doing things that you were doing in the past. And many times even friends become jealous of you because they see now that you have peace in your life, which is so awesome. To have peace that you've never had in your life, experiencing that peace. They come to a place where they continue to reject the truth over and over and over. There is a time, there is a place where that person can say too many times, I don't want Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, and continue to deny that we are sinners. And this is what's called the blasphemy of the Holy Spirit, when you cross that line and not even Jesus can bring you back to the other side. You're done. When a person comes and commits the unpardonable sin, he would not be here today or she would not be here today. Because once you commit the unpardonable sin, there's no longer a conviction. You can do whatever you want to do and not be convicted. Have I ever met people like that? Well, probably I met one or two. And it's so sad because when you talk to them, they reject it. And they go back to John chapter 3:16. I'm going to read from there because it all starts there. He says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. This is what they were fighting against, the Pharisees, the scribes, and the Sadducees. He said, he who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is already condemned, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God, Jesus. And this is the condemnation, that light has come into the world, but men love darkness rather than the light, because their deeds were evil. For everyone practicing evil hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his deeds should be exposed. But he who does the truth comes to the light, that his deeds may be clearly seen that they have been done in God. That person has been with God. Now, people do not realize that many opportunities are given to people. Think of how many opportunities you had before you repented of your sin. I can remember all the opportunities that I had in my life. The problem is when people begin to witness to me, I start feeling guilty, which before I didn't. I could do whatever I wanted to do. But when someone told me about Jesus, which first of all was my wife, and I started getting convicted, then her mom, then her dad, then her grandma, then her grandpa, where I didn't even want other houses because every time I went there, I felt guilty. And maybe you're here today. Everywhere you go, you feel guilty. Well, the reason you feel guilty is because Jesus is waiting for you to drop to your knees and repent. And to come to Christ. To receive him as your Lord and Savior. So that the Holy Spirit, when he gets to come to your life and begins to convict you, you're responding. You're not putting it away. You're not saying another time. But people continue to reject his love and grace and mercies. How can we reject the cross of Jesus Christ, where he died and then he rose again from the dead? Imagine the pain that he went through when he was in the Garden of Gethsemane and he said, okay, Father, not my will, but your will. What do you want me to do? And the will of the Father was what? To have Jesus go to the cross. To submit himself to the cross. What God is looking in each one of us individually is our submission to the cross. Why? Because the cross is the instrument of death. And we see Jesus' mother and brothers who went out as Jesus was minister. They come and they think he's already flipped out. They think that he's crazy. He has a circle of people as he sits there sharing with them. And sharing about the love of God, sharing about all the things that he wanted not only to do through the word of God. And all of a sudden, his mother and his brothers come along and they want to pull him away from the Father's will. And that is preaching, teaching, and healing. And what he does, he says, whoever, notice whoever that does what is my brother and my sister. The will of God has to be fully, completely. Jesus also mentions his family, not only earthly family, but he recognizes that God the Father has sent him into the world. One thing that I want to share also is about Mary. Mary was the mother of Jesus. In Matthew chapter 1:18, note what he says. Now the birth of Jesus Christ was as follows. After his mother Mary was engaged to Joseph, before they came together sexually, she was found with a child by the Holy Spirit. Notice who impregnated her. Then Joseph, her husband, being a just man, not wanting to make her a public example. Now, why does it say that? Because in that culture, any girl getting pregnant before marriage, she would be stoned to death. To make her a public example. He protected her. He says, but while he thought about these things, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take to be your wife Mary, for that which is conceived in her womb is of the Holy Spirit. Twice again. And she will bring forth a son, capital S, and you shall call his name Jesus. For he will save people from their sins. Underline that. Not the priest, not the nun, not Mary, not the Pope. The only person that can forgive sins is Jesus Christ. That's why he came to die on the cross. He goes on and he says, so this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet Isaiah, through the prophet Isaiah saying, behold the virgin, there it is, the virgin, never touched. The virgin shall be with a child. How can you get pregnant without a male? And bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which means God is with us. God is in our presence. Isn't that cool? So, after Jesus was born, Mary and Joseph came together in matrimony, and then they had all these children after Jesus was born. So we have the virginity of Mary, the incarnation of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Again, in Mark chapter 3, verse 33, he says what? He answered them and said, who is my mother? Who is my brothers? And he looked around in the circle of all those who sat by him. And he said, here are my mother and my brothers, and whoever does the will of God is my brother and my sister and my mother. What blew me away is how these people were sitting around and he was sharing the gospel with them. Jesus always was pointing to the will of God. The reason he came according to the will of the Father, and every time they would try to grab a hold of him and they would try to take him, he would say what? He says, my time is not yet. My time is not yet. He was in a timetable. He knew that his time was coming. And if you go and you read the Gospel of Matthew or Mark or Luke in the Garden of Gethsemane, when he got to the Garden of Gethsemane, three times he prayed. Peter, James, and John are there, and they're asleep. And Jesus, every time he came, couldn't you guys watch for 1 hour? But it says this, when Jesus was sitting there praying to the Father, Father, not my will, but your will be done to go to the cross. Do you want me to go to the cross? And what was the answer? Yes, I want you to go to the cross. That was the perfect will of God the Father. To die for you, to die for me on the cross. And the Pharisees and the scribes and the Sadducees were shocked. Because as he was there in Jerusalem praying in the garden, and Judas already was betraying him, from the other side of the Kidron Valley, when they were there with the disciples praying three times, all of a sudden he saw that they were coming across the valley. And who was leading the pack? Judas Iscariot. 500 coming with him to arrest one man. It's so sad that they rejected Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. But today, people are doing the same thing. Jesus is the Lord, the Savior of the world. There is no other Savior but Jesus. He's the only one that has come, the only one that has died, the only one that has risen from the dead, and the only one that's coming back again to the same place, what we call the second coming of Jesus Christ. So we need to understand that God does whatever He pleases because He's in control of my life, control of your life, and control of this world. The desire of all people, what Jesus wanted is the people to be living according to His will. Quote, only in obedience can we discover the great joy of the will of God. I love that. Only in obedience can we truly discover the great joy of the will of God. Do you have the joy of God knowing the will of God? Do you know what God wants for you in your life? You see, we can not only see that people are fully mature in Christ Jesus. People that are not mature, they don't know the will of God. They're carnal. But people that are developing and growing spiritually because they're in the Word of God and God is speaking to them through the Word of God, they come to that place where they say, okay, God, if this is your will, open the door or shut the door. And then you can walk through the door or you can stand behind that door until God opens that door. Psalm 40 verse 8 says this, David, I delight to do your will, O my God, and your law is within my heart. Colossians 4:12, Epaphroditus, who is one of you, a bondservant of Christ, greets you, always laboring fervently for you in prayers, that you may stand perfect and complete in all the will of God. The will of God, the will of God. You see, God's will is always good, acceptable, and perfect. Romans 12, 1 and 2. I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Verse 2. And do not be conformed to this world, but be you transformed by the renewing of your mind. How do I do that? By the word of God. That you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Notice that, will of God. Doing God's will sustains you. It sustained Jesus, his life. In John 4:34, he says, Jesus said to them, my food is to do the will of God who sent me and to finish his work. We know that sometimes that the will of God sometimes leads to suffering. Did you know that? Suffering. We don't want to suffer, but sometimes we have to suffer. Romans 8:28, Paul says, and we know that all things work together for good to those, notice, who love God. You love God, you're going to suffer. To those who are called according to his purpose, we don't really know the purpose of suffering, but you're going to find out his purpose when you come to him. James 1, 2. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. Man, I don't get joyful when I'm in trials. He says, be joyful. Walk around smiling. He says, knowing that the testing of your faith, listen, produces patience. And that's what I need in my life. But let patience, here's the answer, have its perfect work. He says that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. So, I mean, scripture after scripture after scripture. 1 Peter 3:17, for it is better if it is the will of God to suffer for doing good than, notice, than doing evil. So it was the Father's will for Jesus to suffer, to go to the cross, to die on that cross for the sins of the world. Isaiah 53:10 says, yet it pleased the Lord to bruise Jesus. He has put Jesus to grief. When you make Jesus a soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. Jesus. Read Isaiah 53. Matthew 26:39. He went a little further and he fell on his face and prayed, saying, O my Father, If it is possible, let this cup, the cross, pass from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but as you will. If Jesus submitted to the will of the Father, how much more you and I need to submit to the will of the Father so that God can use my life. Matthew 26, 42, again a second time he said, he went away and he prayed, saying, "Oh, my Father, if this cup passes away from me unless I drink it, your will be done." And then we as Christians need to strive to know the will of God for our lives. Psalm 143:10 says, "Teach me to do your will, for you are my God. Your spirit is good. Lead me into the land of uprightness." Romans 1:10, "Making requests if by some means, now at least I may find a way in the will of God to come to you." Ephesians 5:17, "Therefore, do not be unwise, but understand what the will of God is." The will of God all the way through the scriptures. So we as Christians are to discern God's will. How? Through prayer. Listen, Colossians 1:9. "For this reason, we also, since the day we heard it, do not stop praying for you, and ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will," again the will, "in all wisdom and spiritual understanding." The will of God, the will of God. How about Matthew 6:10? "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven." Jesus showing us the will of God.
We hope you've been inspired by Christ's example of submission as you think about how God might use your life to draw others to his salvation. You're listening to Somebody Loves You Radio with Raul Reese. If you'd like to review today's lesson, we'll send you an unedited copy for a donation of $5 or more. The number to call is 800-634-9165. When you make your request, ask for Raul's teaching titled "Doing God's Will, God's Way." We'd also like to tell you about an audio pack with helpful guidance for learning to follow God's leading. Titled "The Call," this 5-message CD series from Raul will show you that you don't have to be a Bible scholar or be called into full-time ministry to be an effective witness. You simply need to walk with the Lord in authenticity and allow his love to shine through you for others to see. Get in touch with us to place your order for "The Call" audio pack. To make your purchase, visit SomebodyLovesYou.com or call 800-634-9165 and ask for Raul's life-shaping 5-CD series. We'll send you this resource for a gift of $20 or more. Our number once again is 800-634-9165. If you'd like to order by writing us, our mailing address is Somebody Loves You Radio, P.O. Box 4440, Diamond Bar, California, 91765. We also invite you to take advantage of all of our free Somebody Loves You resources. Be sure to check out our app. It's available on both iPhones and Androids and features more of Raul's teaching, convenient digital Bible studies, and much more. You'll also want to join Raul on his YouTube channel every Tuesday at 10 a.m. Pacific for Straight Talk, a Q&A program providing scriptural insights for godly living. We're committed to helping you grow in your relationship with the Lord, and we're always looking for new ways to bring you the life-giving truth of God's Word. We welcome your thoughts on how we can best support you, and when you contact us, let us know how we can pray for you as well. This ministry is made possible through your continued prayers and financial support. Your generosity helps keep us on the air, and every gift you give is tax-deductible. Next time, we'll learn more about how we can make an eternal difference as we share Christ's hope and love with the lost and hurting in our lives. Here's Raul now once again with a closing comment.
A man's heart is right when he wills what God wills. When you want what God wants, guess what? You're going to have peace in your life, and he's going to use your life. True conversion has always been what marked by obedience to the Word of God. Obedience to the Word of God. Submitting myself, the authority of Jesus Christ in my life. John 8:31 says, "And then Jesus said to those Jews who believed in him, 'If you abide in my word, You are my disciples indeed. And then John 14, 15, if you love me, keep my commandments. Notice that, the destiny of the church. And then, once again, Mark 3:33, but he answered them saying, who is my mother, my brothers? And he looked around in a circle, are those that sat about him? And he said, here are my mother, my brothers. For whoever does the will of God is my brother, my sister, and my mother. Are you doing the will of God today? Are you doing the will of God in your life? I would pray that if you're not, that before you leave here today, from now on, you would do the perfect will of God in your life, to seek Him, to know Him.
I am falling in love with you.
This program is sponsored by Somebody Loves You Radio in Diamond Bar, California.